It's often claimed that the story of Jesus was plagiarized and adopted from pagan stories. That the concepts of his virgin birth, his baptism, his having disciples, his miracle working, his title as the Son of God, his death, and his resurrection are ideas that were taken from pre-Christ pagan myths and then mishmashed together to give us the unoriginal and recycled story of just another dying and rising savior figure, Jesus Christ.
Does it ever bother you that the story of a man who was born of a virgin, was resurrected, your bio was something that was going around the Mediterranean for at least 1,000 years. We've got Krishna, who was in India 1,000 years before Christ. Krishna was a carpenter, born of a virgin, baptized in a river.
Are you saying that was written in history? That was written down in history?
Absolutely. There's the Persian god Mithra, 600 years before Christ, born December 25th, performed miracles, resurrected on the third day, known as the Lamb, the Way, the Truth, the Light, the Savior, Messiah.
Stop! Blasphemer!
And since we apparently have stories of gods that predate Jesus, who had the exact same outline and ministry as he did, it suggested that the story of Jesus is actually a knockoff of pagan stories that come before him. Here is a short clip from a documentary that was released called Zeitgeist.
Mithra of Persia, born of a virgin on December 25th. He had 12 disciples and performed miracles, and upon his death was buried for 3 days and thus resurrected. Dionysus of Greece, born of a virgin on December 25th, was a traveling teacher who performed miracles such as turning water into wine. He was referred to as the King of Kings, God's only begotten Son, the Alpha and Omega, and many others. And upon his death, he was resurrected. Horus was born on December 25th of the Virgin Isis Mary. Horus was crucified, buried for 3 days, and thus resurrected. The fact of the matter is, there are numerous saviors from different periods from all over the world which subscribe to these general characteristics.
Here, Rob Bell gets it on this idea too, in his series called Pneuma.
The claims of these first Christians weren't really anything new. Everybody's God had risen from the dead. What makes yours so special?
And so does Jacqueline Glenn, the popular YouTube atheist.
Mithras was a Roman god. He was the savior. He was sent to earth to live as a mortal. He died for our sins so that sinners could have everlasting life. But of course, he was resurrected from the dead. He was born from a virgin on December 25th. And guess what? He was born in a manger with lots of shepherds, and they referred to him as the light of the world. He also had 12 disciples, and they also had a Last Supper before he died. Now, a lot of different religious scholars will debate certain aspects of these different gods and say, well, that wasn't true, and that wasn't true. But you can't begin to debate them all. You can't say that there's no credibility for any of them being historically accurate, and historically accurate as saying that's how the people viewed that particular god. You can't dispute every single claim.
Of course you can, and we're going to do that right now. Here are three major reasons that we know Jesus is not a knockoff or plagiarism of pagan god stories. The first point is that the parallels are either not there or completely made up. Let's look at Mithra, for example. Mithra has absolutely no virgin birth. In fact, Mithra was not even born in a literal sense. He emerged out of a rock. Mithra was only born metaphorically, not literally. Here are some of Mithra's petrogenetrixes, carvings indicating he was born from a rock. And the funny thing is, he even emerged out of this rock as an adult, not as a baby. Mithra has no mother, virgin birth, and certainly no manger. Mithra was also never actually killed, let alone crucified. As Mithraic scholar Gordon Richard says, there is no death of Mithras. And if he didn't die, that of course means there was no Last Supper, no crucifixion, no burial, and no resurrection on the third day. Now, how about Dionysus? Dionysus was born from Zeus having sex with Semele. In Hesiod's poem called Theogony, it reads that, and Semele, daughter of Cadmos, was joined with him, Zeus, in love, and bare him a splendid son, joyous Dionysus. A mortal woman, an immortal son, and now they both are gods. And while some other stories cite Persephone as the mother of Dionysus, no stories indicate a virgin birth. Dionysus died by being torn up into a bunch of pieces by the Titans, and boiled in a pot and eaten by them. There are at least 6 different accounts of what happens to him after that. While most restoration accounts are too ambiguous to matter, there is one story that reads Dionysus was deceived by the Titans and expelled from the throne of Jupiter and torn in pieces by them, and his remains being afterwards put together again, he returned as it were once more to life and ascended to heaven. Pretty close to the story of Jesus. The problem is this source, Contra Celsum, was written by the early church father Origen in 248 AD, over 2 centuries after the story of Jesus had already been established and circulating. This is a post-Christ resurrection story, If anything, it may have been the Dionysus cults that adopted this idea from Christianity. As historian Dr. Gary Habermas has said,
I don't know anybody who thinks Dionysus is pre-Christian, not the resurrection portion.
So when it comes to Dionysus, we find no virgin birth, no crucifixion, and no pre-Christ bodily resurrection. As for Horus, he also had no virgin birth. Isis had sex with Osiris after reassembling his body parts, which were torn apart and scattered over Egypt. As Egyptologist and professor at the University of Arizona, Dr. Richard Wilkinson has written, through her magic, Isis revivified the sexual member of Osiris and became pregnant by him, eventually giving birth to their child, Horus. Historian and professor Francois Denand writes, after having sexual intercourse in the form of a bird with the dead god she restored to life, she gave birth to a posthumous son, Horus. We even have an ancient depiction of Isis hovering over the erect phallus of Osiris. Was Horus crucified? There actually exists not a single record of Horus ever even dying. Since he didn't die, this means he wasn't buried in a tomb or resurrected from the dead. Atheist historian Bart Ehrman is one of the most renowned New Testament scholars of our day. He is professor of religious studies at the University of North Carolina. He has said that the alleged parallels between Jesus and the pagan savior gods in most instances reside in modern imagination. We do not have accounts of others who were born to virgin mothers and who died as an atonement for sin and then were raised from the dead, despite what the sensationalists claim ad nauseam in their propagandized versions. Historian J.Z. Smith famously said in his essay in the Encyclopedia of Religion, the category of dying and rising gods, once a major topic of scholarly investigation, must now be understood to have been largely a misnomer based on imaginative reconstructions in exceedingly late or highly ambiguous texts. There is no unambiguous instance in the history of religions of a dying and rising deity. So while the story of Jesus is often compared to pagan myths, primary sources for these myths demonstrate that the similarities are either spurious, ambiguous, or completely made up. A second major point is that the story of Jesus can be established from historical sources, meaning any similarities we do find are unrelated to the origin of these beliefs about Jesus. It may surprise some to hear that all academic scholars agree Jesus existed as a historical figure. As Bart Ehrman says, there is no scholar in any college or university in the Western world who teaches classics, ancient history, New Testament, early Christianity, any related field, who doubts that Jesus existed. Graham Clark, professor of classical history and archaeology at Australian National University, has said, frankly, I know of no ancient historian or biblical historian who would have a twinge of doubt about the existence of a Jesus Christ. Furthermore, some aspects of the life of Jesus are universally agreed upon by historians. Let's take the crucifixion for example. We can demonstrate the crucifixion of Jesus on 11 ancient independent sources, maybe even more. Our best secular source comes from the reliable Roman historian and senator Tacitus, where he writes, consequently, to get rid of the report, Nero fastened the guilt and inflicted the most exquisite tortures on a class hated for their abominations, called Christians by the populace. Christus, from whom the name had its origin, suffered the extreme penalty during the reign of Tiberius at the hands of one of our procurators, Pontius Pilatus. Atheist professor of New Testament history at the University of Göttingen, Gerd Ludemann, has said, Jesus' death as a consequence of crucifixion is indisputable. Bart Ehrman has said, one of the most certain facts of history is that Jesus was crucified on orders of the Roman prefect of Judea, Pontius Pilate. So even if we have pre-Christ myths of gods who died in some way, it's simply irrelevant since Jewish, Roman, and Christian history all confirm that Jesus was killed on a cross. And if it happened in history, that means it wasn't plagiarized. His baptism, his belief that he had authority from God, his gathering of disciples, and his working of what people believe to be miracles are other established facts universally agreed upon by historians. Because these portions of Jesus' story are rooted in history itself, pagan myths have absolutely no bearing or relevance to the origin of these beliefs about Jesus. And a last major point is that this theory doesn't explain anything. It is said that the story of Jesus' resurrection was adopted and recapitulated from the stories of dying and rising gods in the ancient world. The problem with this is that most scholars agree that shortly after his crucifixion, the disciples had experiences of what they believed was the risen Jesus. Historians don't all agree on the nature of these experiences, but the fact that the disciples had experiences that caused them to believe Jesus had really appeared to them is itself a fact of history. Prominent atheist historian Ed Parrish Sanders has said that Jesus' followers, and later Paul, had resurrection experiences is, in my judgment, a fact. What the reality was that gave rise to the experiences, I do not know. Atheist historian Gerd Ludemann has said it may be taken as historically certain that Peter and the disciples had experiences after Jesus' death in which Jesus appeared to them as the risen Christ. In regards to the amount of experts who believe this, New Testament historian Mike Lacona has said,
"Now I'm just giving you minimalistic things that virtually 100% of scholars would agree upon. And we can know that shortly thereafter, a number of his followers had experiences that persuaded them that Jesus had been raised from the dead and had appeared to them." That would be nearly 100%. And then you would have...
So you're talking atheist scholars,
Jewish scholars, liberal, you know, almost everybody.
Since we know the disciples really had these kinds of experiences, this means something caused them to have these experiences. Paul, for example, was a Jewish Pharisee who held to a strict Old Testament worldview. What kind of experience could cause Paul, a Jewish Pharisee who once ordered the execution of Christians, to believe he experienced a physical bodily appearance of Jesus Christ? Do we really think this experience was caused by him hearing a myth about Osiris being put back together by Isis? The mere presence of pagan stories floating around Jerusalem can't cause people to have these kinds of experiences, nor can it cause people to genuinely believe they found an empty tomb, another fact agreed upon by the majority of historians. This theory does not adequately address historical facts surrounding these resurrection claims, and it also requires us to make assumptions about the early disciples. We don't even know the disciples knew the details of these pagan stories, let alone that they were influenced by them. As Bart Ehrman has written, anyone who thinks that Jesus was modeled on such deities needs to cite some evidence, any evidence at all, that Jews in Palestine at the alleged time of Jesus' life were influenced by anyone who held such views. It also fails to offer a causal link between these pagan myths and the early beliefs about Jesus. It's not enough to say that Jesus' resurrection story sounds a little bit like the story of Dionysus. We must prove historically that these pagan myths caused the disciples to believe these things about Jesus, which is far too heavy of a burden of proof for any historian or skeptic to bear. This theory utterly fails as an explanation. Trygg Mettinger, a Swedish scholar and former professor at Lund University, has authored one of the most comprehensive works ever written in the field of dying and rising gods and its relationship to Christianity. He concludes his book by saying the following, "There is, as far as I'm aware, no prima facie evidence that the death and resurrection of Jesus is a mythological construct, drawing on myths and rites of the dying and rising gods of the surrounding world. While studied with profit against the background of Jewish resurrection belief, the faith in the death and resurrection of Jesus retains its unique character in the history of religions." So while works like Zeitgeist, Religulous, and other popular type material tells us Jesus is a mishmash of pagan stories, history reveals something much different. We can clearly see that this theory relies on ambiguous or fabricated similarities. It ignores the wealth of historical evidence we have for Jesus, and it lacks causal significance as an explanation. For these three reasons, and many others, experts are universally convinced that pagan mythology had absolutely no role in the story of Jesus or the origin of Christian beliefs.